Today, we're going to talk about the future of edge agents and try to understand together what the heck an agent really is. So to build agents, you need models. So we'll first go through a sneak peek of the Mistral models, some of which you might already know. And you also introduce newcomers in the Mistral family that we just released yesterday, fresh from the oven, and that are specifically tailored for agentic workloads. Then we try to customize and tailor these models to the edge, where they will be the most useful. And finally, conclude with some remarks on what an agent should or should not be, and hopefully a live demo. The most prominent member of the Mistral family is Mistral Large, 123 billion parameters. And the key takeaway for this model is that it's large enough. In particular, it's 3 times smaller than Llama 3. And for instance, on this particular leaderboard, the scale 1 on coding capabilities, as of yesterday, it's better than this model, so than the Llama 1. It has strong multilingual support, a lot of other perks, like native function calling, which is super important for agents, as we will see just in a moment. You might be familiar with Pixtral as well, our very first multimodal model, image and text as input, and it's already super small, 12 billion parameters. And once again, it's more than 7 times smaller than Llama Vision, so the 90B, and it's arguably better, for instance here, that's a generic task, LLM6, so Chat Arena, where people ask questions about images and chat with the model. So what we've done here is really push the Pareto frontier of performance and efficiency. And we intend to push it further. So this talk is about edge. Why edge? Well, as you might know, edge devices are everywhere. It's ubiquitous. Smartphones, smart glasses, laptops, and really any device or object that has some compute and that is embedded into your house, your bike, whatever. And those devices, the key property is that they follow you everywhere you go, by design, because they want to act and to help you on your day-to-day. So the key challenge is to be able to maintain the privacy of data that the device sees, but also of all the artifacts that they create, for instance, models or agents. If you have a personal booking agent tailored to your schedule, you don't want the data, the appointments, nor the agent that might know about all your habits to go on the cloud, outside of your personal ecosystem. And the fun thing for a scientist like me is that it comes with a lot of nice constraints. So you want to be able to generate for prompt and generation tokens at reading speed, so almost 10 tokens per second. So that's a lot for edge devices. And also, you have a lot of constraints on the memory. So you want to fit the model into a few gigabytes of RAM. That's why I'm super thrilled to introduce you to the Ministral, so the edge model that we released just yesterday, fresh from the oven. And yeah, what we really tried to do is to push the frontier and to make these models as good as possible. So how good are they? Introducing Ministral 3B, so it's a 3 billion parameter model. And this model is more than 2 times smaller than Mistral 7B. And if you recall, Mistral 7B is the very first model we cooked, 1 year ago, because we're only 1 year old. And the fun fact is that this model, so Mistral 3B, is better than Mistral 7B on all benchmarks here. So MAT is MAT. MPPP is coding, and the 3 other ones are chat in real-life conversations. And they're better than Llama and Gemma for their respective bucket size. And they also have native function calling. We put a lot of love into the function calling aspect. That's going to be super important, as you're going to see after. So that's the 3B, and the 8B is same, just bigger. So it's a super good model. Of course, better than the 7B, better than Llama and Gemma on their bucket category on most instruct benchmarks. And it has the special perks that we'll introduce to make it fit really on the edge. So now we have the model, the Ministrol, or the Ministro. Let's see how we can take them and put them, embed them in the edge. And as you can imagine, it comes with a lot of constraints. So let's say we have Ministrol 3B, and we have a device, so CPU, XPU, GPU, NPU, you name it. And you want to embed the model on the device. And you have 3 GB of RAM. If you do it naively, you would take the precision we use for training the models. And the precision we use is FP or BFLOW 16. So that's 16 bits per weight. So that's 2 bytes per weight. So that's 6 GB. And as you can see on this beautiful slide, it does not fit. So you need to quantize. And to quantize, the first idea is to reduce the precision of the weights. So each weight is now not 2 bytes, but 1 byte. And the way you do that is you take the weight matrix, you scale it to the range of integers that you target, here 0 to 2 to the 8 minus 1, so 2 to the power of 1 byte minus 1, 255, and you round the weight, the gray one, to the nearest integer, the red one, and then you descale. As you can imagine, it incurs a loss of precision. And we're going to see in a while how to make it up with our special stack. So int 8 is good, 3 GB, it fits right on the device. But the problem is you can't do inference in this setup because of the KV cache. So we'll see in a moment what the KV cache is, but let's assume, OK, we want to quantize further. So now we can go to int 4, and int 4 begins to be quite a beast because it's only 16 load values per weight. So imagine your transformer, a lot of floating precision numbers, and for the weights, it's going to mean not only 16 load values, modulo the scale that can change for the blocks of weights. If you do that, you can fit in memory, right? 1.5 gigs, half a byte per weight. And then what do you do with the other 1.5 gigs? Well, that's for the KV cache. But what's the KV cache? So as you might know, transformers are autoregressive models. So you forward what you've done so far, and then you predict the next token, and then the next, and then the next. And basically, the transformer is made of some attention mechanisms. So you have an attention layer, every transformer layer that are stacked. So let's say you have 4 tokens so far, the cat sat on, and you want to predict the next one. At each layer, what's going to happen is that the attention is going to produce 3 artifacts per token, the key, the value, and the query, so Q, K, and V. I think at this point, you can guess what the KV cache is. It's K and V. But why do you need to cache it, actually? Well, the query of the last token is just going to tell you where you want to attend in the past to make your prediction. Depending on where you are in the sentence, there might be places where you don't care about in the past, right? Here, you would look most likely at the subject and the verb to make the prediction. You don't care about the though, most likely. So you take the query of only the last token. You do the dot product with all the past key values. That's going to tell you where you want to attend, where you want to put your attention, and then you wait with the value V. So that's the attention. The problem is, if you do that naively, you would recompute K and V for all the past tokens every time you want to reprocess the sentence. So the cost is going to go quadratically. You're going to be slower and slower at predicting tokens. That's bad. So what you do is you trade off compute for memory, and you cache K and V on the GPU. So that's the KV cache. And as you can imagine, it scales as number of tokens, number of layers, because there's one attention mechanism per layer, and the head dimension, because these guys, actually, their vectors of size canonically 128. So 1.5 gigs for the KV cache. Is it good? Is it good enough for your application? It depends. If you consider the KV cache in full precision, as you can see on the graph, you can fit a bit less than 32K tokens, intersection blue-gray. If you want to quantize it in ITate, then it's a bit less than 64K tokens. So that's irrelevant of two factors I totally neglected. The first one is the speed. Actually, when you quantize, you reduce the space, but also you make the model go faster. So not twice faster, if you're lucky, 1.5 from 16 to 8 and from 8 to 4. And also, the model loses accuracy if you do it naively, right? 16 values per weight, you're going to destroy the model completely and waste all the effort you put in the data, the training, the fine-tuning, and the compute, which is a waste. So that's why we have a proprietary quantization-aware training stack, which basically allows you to quantize losslessly to 4 bits for the weights and 8 bits for the KV cache. The idea is super simple. You forward during training, you fake quantize the weights and the activation during the forward pass, and during the backward pass, you use the straight-through estimator, which is a pedantic way of saying you use the gray original values for the backward. So it's a way to train the model to be resilient to the quantization you're going to apply after in prod. And I say int4 quantization, but actually there are as many quantization in int4 as chips. There's a lot of variations in quantization on exactly the way to quantize the models, the zero points, the blocks, the channel quantization, etc., etc. So the idea of this stack is that it's super versatile. So I put the config of your chip, and then I get the model out. So I run a sweep on a Ministral 3B. Each dot is one instance of the model quantized. And the orange lines is the model that's non-quantized, so the reference. So I guess you can guess the winner of the sweep, which is on the top right. And that means it's lossless. Actually, it's within noise of being on par with the non-quantized model. So now we have a Ministral 3B. We know how to make it fit on a chip. We know it doesn't lose any accuracy, but we want to do even better, because we want to be able to handle even longer context. And I'll tell you why in a moment. So that's the last technical thing I want to share with you. It's called interleaved sliding windows. So the idea is super simple. It's a mix of local and global attention. For local attention, you allow one token to look only in the four, say, nearest tokens in the past. It's local. But then, if you stack local patterns, then the second layer will be able to see 8 tokens in the past, because it's going to be able to see on 4 tokens in the past here, but then this token will have information about also the token before. And you stack those sliding layers, and we found out that there's a trade-off between a model full of sliding windows, or having some layers that still have the standard full attention pattern. So here it's a trade-off, because the sliding layer is faster and less and more memory efficient, because the KV cache is reduced. You need to cache the past, right? So here the 4 tokens in the past, and precision and robustness to long context. And here I added a red line, and I guess you could guess what sliding windows I used for the red model. So the sliding windows is 32K, because that's where there is an inflection in the curve. Before that, I'm full. And after that, I begin to see gains from these interleaved sliding windows. And I can go almost up to 120K tokens. So I bothered you a lot with the quantization and long context. So why do we care? Because agents are token hungry. Yes, but what is an agent? So I don't have a golden definition. At least I have a vision to share with you. That's pretty much alpha at this stage. Say you take Ministral 3B. You want to input it high-level instructions. Book me an appointment for tomorrow with my doctor. The model is not alone. is able to retrieve some context. If you know RAG, so you can put some context, and that's going to eat up a lot of tokens. And the model also has tools, and the tool is just a way to be connected to external APIs and to act on it. For instance, retrieve the doctor calendar status, and then integrate the result to book the appointment, and then redirect a tool to book the appointment. And then you get the answer. And when I talk about tools, it's really about function calling. So in a nutshell, function calling is a super nice property of LLMs, which is you have a set of functions, and you describe them in plain English. So here the function is you want to get the payment status of a transaction. And really, like what's on the slide is exactly what you feed to the model. Oops. So you have an English description. And then you have arguments that the model can populate. And then the model is going to output a tool call. You are responsible for calling whatever tool you have. And then you send the answer back to the model, and the model just carries on. And the funny thing is that a single tool is worth 100 tokens, a bit more, a bit less, depending on how you specify it, if you're very verbose in the description or not. And actually, you want the agent to interact with a lot of tools. So a lot of tools will also eat up a lot of context. So that's why you need absolutely a lot of context for function calling. And you want to do it right over hundreds of tools. And that's what we mean by native function calling. And there's a small bonus point if you notice that you can actually cache the KV cache across requests if the prefix is the same, the prefix being the fixed set of tools that you have. OK, so I guess it's now demo time. It's a super simple version of what an agent could look like. And you can try it out. It's like public on the platform. So I'm on the Mistral platform. My name is Pierre. Welcome, Pierre. And I want to create an agent. I go ahead. And the agent is going to be like Pixtrol, so the multimodal text and image input model. I don't care about the temperature of that much. And let's say I want a model that parses some badly handwritten table that you just wrote in a rush into some JSON, so like a structured output formatting. So that's the instruction, just format to JSON. And obviously, the name is going to be JSONStrol. So that's my agent, super simple. Once again, in the future, you're going to be able to enrich it with a lot of custom tools that you have. I deploy the agent, and I want to deploy it on the API, so to be able to call it, but also on Lusha, which is our platform right here. So I'm on Lusha, and then I have the ability to select my model, which is obviously not here. Interesting. So let's say my agent is Pixtrol. And then what I really do here is to have the instruction right there. So I want to attach a table. So the table is super, super badly written. It's like some instructions. And I just ask the model, OK, can you format this table into something readable? And then the agent outputs some nice JSON formatted output. And that's what you're going to use after to connect everything to your ecosystem. You might want after to retrieve any status for the order. You might be able to make an SQL database out of that. And the model is going to not do it alone. It's going to call SQL or database or anything in your ecosystem. So my last remark is for you to just try. Go ahead on the platform, build your own agents, and notice that this journey is like 1% finished, as I say. So we have a lot of things to do, and stay tuned, and thanks a lot for the talk.